We usually break it out in two parts because we know that some of the other parts, sometimes we get people who come from other institutions and they're in the process of applying. So they're ready to apply this year. So they have a different goal or set in mind. Okay. So that's why we have a part where they practice like interviewing, or they practice, you know, what are tips that they should do when they apply that are more focused on them in the right now. So for you guys, some of that is not what your focus point is. But I will say it's never too early to at least think about things. You know, we always get students here, and we have students, some that actually finish sixth year and then are already going to apply. Okay, so your peers that usually they're from Jula, that is, I think that's the place that produces most of them. They have already done step one, step two, step three. Now you don't even have to do step three. It's a different test that you can take in lieu of that. But they're all prepared. They're all ready. So they're your same age. They're your peers. So while they were doing medical school, they did all the steps required so that they could go ahead and move to that step. So that's why I also think there's very different pathways to getting to this. Not everybody is going to do it right out of the gate, and many people will do it sometimes years afterwards or whatnot because things change. This is all, you know, your life, essentially, because we, as your professors, we're not going to be with you every day after this. So you're going to have your own family, you're going to have your friends, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, so you will make decisions that will be different from everybody else, okay? So that's what the goal of this is, and that's why we have to make you guys come to it, because if not, I have a tendency to think that you guys will not come to these things, okay? So that's what we're going to be talking about today. So our first speaker is Achan Nantra. So Achan Nantra, many of you have known, is our infectious disease expert. So she did her you know, training in the United States, and then obviously she came back. So she's going to talk a little bit about some of the good things and the bad things and kind of her perspective. And then I'll kind of talk a little bit of a more broader overview after that. And then we'll kind of break for a different session. Then depending on who is still around, we'll work those details out. All right. So first we will welcome Achan Nantra to the stage, and then we'll go from there. Okay.
Okay. Seem to be like majority of people is here, but this also here. So for today, thank you, Achan Thep, and everyone that come to this program. Actually, yeah, this 7 year already, you can see that Achan Thep keep doing this for like the advice for the international and things. One is about the USMLE examination. My part, I just want to share some of my experience, and let's like give you some idea, and maybe you can also think what you want and what's your plan and what you want to do. Yeah, so these are my things. Yeah, actually, kind of like before going abroad, maybe you have to ask yourself, answer some question first, and then you can maybe that you get some idea what you are doing right now. Let's say like, what's your plan? Yeah, what is your exactly plan? Yeah, a lot of people maybe want to stay in Thailand. Some of people want to go someplace or want to be something. So maybe you should think about this. Is what exactly your plan? Yeah, maybe it doesn't need to be a big plan, big like things, but maybe sometimes we call it one step at a time, right? One step at a time. Yeah. What is your, sometimes you have to think about your personality as well, or what is your idea that you want to be, want to do. Sometimes you have no idea, it's fine, but you have to think or get some more information. That's the way that you can develop your idea. Otherwise, you will do as like, I mean, let's say your mom said, please do this. Your dad said, do that. Yeah, sometimes I don't know it's from your heart or not, right? When you try to do something. And I like this one, like, and our talk, my talk is also the things that I like to ask you as well, like, what's your plan? Like, you want to go abroad or actually you don't want, you want to be a doctor or not? Actually, that's, you have to ask yourself first. But if you decide, make decision already, you hear already at CICM, Thammasat, so you have to go further and further. So maybe think about this. Good thing, bad things, this one is the way that we can develop the strong plan. You have to know like is what is good or bad. Yeah, this one is kind of like a, you have to compare. And if you really want to go there, if you really want to go to US or go abroad, you need to be a good one, right? Good applicant. The same idea like how you come to here to us, to CICM, you do the portfolio, right? This, I think it's the same idea like to go abroad. You need to kind of like a prepare to be a good applicant a little bit. But that's for this part, sometimes it's changed, right? A lot of things change, right? The ECFMG, this one is the kind of like a, the institute that will give you the permit to work, to study at in the US as a doctor. So sometimes you have to follow them or you have to make your profile a little bit better by maybe research, observership, interview, whatever you can do. Some you need to pay for it. Yeah, you have to, everything you have to kind of like do something. Yeah, I don't think that you can just like pray or like ask someone, make it by just want to be, but you have to evaluate yourself and do it. And you see. And again, this based on my personal experience, some people maybe have different experience. So just like want to share with you. One thing I think I like you to think about how to study medicine. Now, actually, you guys also in kind of like a post-COVID, I don't know, we come to post-COVID or we still in the COVID era or some point, right? But right now they like to use the words like post-pandemic or something. So you can think it's changed, right? I don't know you like or you don't like it, but I mean, you can think about yourself last year when you like were at home, do online, hybrid, whatever. Right now we come to like hybrid learning, but this one I'll show you. It's at Vienna Hospital, 1907. So that's when you do anatomy. Yeah, the black guy, like the this or this one is the medical student. It's the same idea. Like now I'm here, right? And where's the anatomy, the cadaver? I don't know. Someone want to come here and be my cadaver or not? But it's okay. But just want to show you. This is the how we do, how they learned the in the medical school at that time. Yeah, actually, for the medicine, it start in like Europe, right? Europe, European country, UK, Germany, right? Yeah. Before in the US, people have to went to Europe to study, to kind of like follow the professor and came back for in the US to like create the medical school. Like the first medical school in the US, I think is UPenn, University of Pennsylvania, and start to have like Harvard University, blah, 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 blah. Like at the Johns Hopkins, Professor Osler also at some point went to Europe to study a lot of things and came to the US to create the medical school over there. But now today some change, right? Something changed, like US also strong in some of the training. That's why we want to go, you want to go there. But for me, I think this the some idea that I'll show this picture because I want to show you that things change. Nowadays, sometimes everything can like more like globalize how to come to the US to train at some point, some part, maybe it's changed. So have to think about this too. Actually, it also depends on you. The more that you can develop yourself, I think you work hard. Anywhere you can learn, but sometimes at some place, some area, there might be more opportunity. Some area, some place, there might have a little bit more specialist, a little bit more about some structure that can support you to do something. And sometimes it's about the opportunity that you have to make as well. So that's kind of like the things that I think you have to think about this. With the COVID, a lot of bad things, right? Sometimes we think about the COVID, we feel like, oh, it's so bad. Oh, I don't know, you like it or not, like you stay home, right? But for me, some area is not good. But I think for COVID-19, we also have a lot of opportunity as well. Like the now we can do, right? We can do the online learning, a lot of things that we can is make, they move it fast in terms of the how to improve all these things. We have like the virtual things, right? Pathology, anatomy, or whatever. And for me, you have to apply. And I can tell that right now, entire lot of things that now in the US have, but it's just like some part may be different in terms of the infrastructure, some regulation. Before when I went to the US, at that time, the training over there, they have a lot of like limitation in terms of like kind of like you have like work, you can do over call overnight on call, but in the early morning you have to leave the hospital by noon. In Thailand we don't have that regulation, right? We have to work whole day, 2 days in a row or something. But now I heard from the medical council that they plan for this regulation right now, that in the very near future they will have some type of the working hour regulation for the intern, for the training residents and fellows. So something that maybe is changed in terms of the pro and cons, the risk benefit that you can think about. One thing I like to ask you, what is the true success? If you think that you have to go abroad, that's the true success. I'm not sure that I go abroad and I'm success or not that I'm here. I have to ask Ajahn Thep that, do you feel success that you're here, or I don't know, right? But for me, I'm happy. I'm happy that I'm here to work, to see you, to be the professor here at some point. But one thing, this from Prince Mahidol, right? That he also mentioned a long time ago. He's the father of Thai modern medicine, right? He said like true success is not the learning, right? But in its application to the benefit of mankind, right? So when you try to do something, maybe you think about this a little bit. Sometimes you do a lot of things is for you, for yourself, or for someone. So think about this, and then that may help you to, I mean, for me to go abroad, maybe you're so young, and I saw your elective, right? You went to elective. Several people went to several places to your international elective. Yeah, you are very good in terms of like you can travel by yourself and a lot of things stay by yourself. For me, at that time, it's quite new for me in terms of like you need to be alone to study abroad. And I don't know, you went there for your elective, it's how many weeks, right? But this one, if you go USMLE, it means you want to train at least 2-3 years, yeah, in the US. Yeah, so you have to kind of like a work and also study at the same time. For me, it's not like a study, like a do thesis or PhD student, but usually you work with the patient, you practice as a with the patient. That's why the way that they try to ask you, like, do you have US observational experience? Did you do some research? That's one is for me, it's more like they try to ask you that, are you familiar with the US system, right? They just want to ask you like, are you familiar with their system? That otherwise, let's say they accept you to for the class, for the with the class, but 3 months after you work, you left, right? You quit. And how the program, in the program, they need to have, let's say, 10, 20 doctors. We call the intern or resident each year. And if you're not familiar with the system, you quit, how they gonna do? So that's the things that when they try to select the applicant, that's it, actually. Yeah, but there are a lot of people, right? Not only Thai people that want to go to the US. There's like from India, Indian, a lot of Indian people from Caribbean, Korea, whatever, a lot of several players in the world try to come to the US. So that's why they can select, that's it. So that's why they try to have some criteria for you, like you have to pass some exam, you have to do this, do that. So this one, this slide, actually I share with you guys, if you're from CICM, I already share several times. Yeah, but if some of you, if you are not from us, so I'll usually ask you to like, to think, if you want to be a doctor, right, you need to study, like, in Thailand, it's like 6 years. But you have to think also, like, after that, if you want, right, you want to be what kind of specialist, what kind of thing you want to be. So you usually need to do more training. If in Thailand, you have to do internship, and then you apply for residency training 3 to 5 years, depends on your specialty you want to be. For internal medicine, just 3 years, but for surgery, 4 years at least. If you want to be like fellowship or some training, you have to do more, 2 more years, 3 more years, sometimes 5 years, right? So have to plan about this one. You want to be the physician, still want to see the doctor, to be kind of like a specialist. You like to have some organ, heart doctor, right? Kidney doctor, GI doctor, or what you want. Or right now, sometimes we call physician scientist. You also do some research, but you do see the patient, or we call translational research at some point, like apply some basic research to the patient care. You can do that. Or some people like to do only research, like they found themselves. Maybe they want to be a doctor at some point, but sometimes the majority of them, they like to do more about the research. You can do that. So Because some different of the specialty is maybe have some impact or some impact about your plan, about your plan to go abroad as well. Because sometimes, especially in Thailand, some specialty right now, they not allow you to like just train in the US or UK and then you come back to Thailand and you can practice. Right now, some specialty, you cannot do that. Some specialty can do, but right now, most of them, like some of them, you need to like pass some exam. You have to, sometimes you have to do some re-evaluation. So this one is like, can affect about your plan. Now, for me, in the medical school, it's the precious time that you can think about this. Let's like the same idea, like at your level right now. Good that this talk is like after your international elective, right? So you have some idea that you see the patient in the hospital, you see a lot of doctor, you have some more idea, not only your preclinical year that you learn too much about the lecture. Nah? So one thing, let's plan what you want, what you really want. Today we focus to US, right, USA, but other place, maybe several places that you can study as well. I'll show you, this is my, I just have to bring this to the hospital. They asked me, I practice here like seven years already, but they just asked me to submit my like certificate, something like that. So I just found that, oh, this is my ECFMG that I did not like just like cheat you, right? That I passed the evaluation. So in this one is actually the one that you, if you want to go to the US, you are like foreign, they call us foreign grad, or sometimes they call alien physician. In my visa, they call me like alien physician. Yeah, at that time, right? You have to do that. So, and this is my USMLE score. Yeah. I try to make it small that you cannot see my score, right? But actually I'm good, right? You can see. Yeah. But it's okay. I just show you that the ECFMG, they develop a lot about the regulation. Right now, I heard from I that she's the first class EP. She also did a lot of training and also did the exam. It seemed like it's easy for now. They cannot do the clinical evaluation something, and then they change to try to evaluate your English performance. And for some people told me that it's very difficult. It's very difficult, but some people like who that use very good in English, they said, they told me that it's fine, it's very easy. Yeah, so it's depend, right? It's depend. That's kind of like things about me. I think I'll skip this one. I just show you that I passed the US USMLE, right? So that's one, it's kind of like a guarantee that I have some experience about the testing and about how to prepare things. I cannot tell you, but you have to think about this, like, is it real good or real bad in terms of like to go abroad? Or sometimes when you have to make decision, it's kind of like a by judgment, nothing right or wrong, but you have to just think, and then you have to, this one, we told you already about goal success. One thing I'll ask you, are you happy? When you do something, for me, I'll tell my student, you have to be, I know that who's want to like wake up early, right? You want to like stay travel and play or stay with your family. But for your work, you have to work unless you have a lot of money, right? You don't have, that's when you don't have to work. But if you want to be a doctor, at some point, yeah, you have to have some feeling of happiness. Yeah, you have to happy to do something. Like, I know, I understand, I passed your level before, like, now you start at 9, right? Usually the class start at 9. But when you go to clinic, when the class start, right? You went to observe at the hospital, 7 or early. Right now, sometimes the resident came late, actually, but before you have to be in the hospital very early. But sometimes this feeling is not, you work hard, you tired, but if you can take care some of your patient and they get better, this kind of like feeling that maybe you have, yeah, this kind of the feeling of happiness that you may have, yeah. But this one, again, in Thailand or go abroad, you have to think about this. Yeah, you have to know yourself. What is your level? Yeah, your communication, English communication, your management and things. Yeah, without bias. Because over there, you have to be alone. My mom always said that after I train and everything, she said that she cannot believe that, she could not believe that I did that. But that's one, like, after 10 years of my training, right? Like, what did you do? Or something like that. But she's not in the kind of the doctor or health side. So actually my family just know that, I am like infectious disease doctor. What did I do? What did my training after this COVID, right? Because before what is infectious disease, right? They don't have the idea, something like that. Yeah, but you have to looking for information and seeking for opportunities and self-improvement. Like today, the class that Ajahn Thep will give you some information, also some of the idea that you can see more. I kind of like a summary of the good and bad fact about going abroad. For me, going abroad, you may have a lot of good opportunity. You got like we call American board examination. Yeah, it's international standard. You have the international standard, but this one I'll ask you, it also depends on the country that you work. If you want to work in America, you need to have American board. If you want to work in Thailand, I'm not sure you need American board or not, because I just told you some of the doctor in Thailand before, if you get American board, Thai Medical Council will give you Thai board, you know, right away. But right now they change some of the specialty, they change about this one. But one thing, you have the research experience. For me, this one is the good things for the US, because in terms of their infrastructure, they support more for you to do research, to practice some more about the this research experience. Sometimes for me, I feel that they have some kind of like they have some schedule that more fixed, more support. In Thailand, actually right now, for your training, actually you have to do the research as well, for the residency and fellowship. For for me in Thailand, I feel that the resident and the fellow is work very hard because they have to take care of the patient. They have to do the research at the same time, something like that. The disease may be very variety. You have like, yeah, this one I told you already about working hour. In the US, for me, when I train there, I don't have to do what we call moonlight. You wear not well, working after hour. You have the time. You have to on call. For me, some people told me like they like to go abroad because like, learning more easier than Thai system. I'm not sure because I take care on my service when I train over there. I took care of a lot of patients. I did not feel that it's more easier. Yeah, but for me, I think it's more structural. You have to do a lot of paperwork. Yeah. In Thailand now, we also have to do more paperwork. And for me, in Thailand, about the lawsuit is not much right now, but the more of the the system right now, for me, I can tell that there will be the more about the lawsuit and a lot of things that people will be more crazy. Yeah, so you have to careful about how to practice. But actually, if you good, you try to do good things, for me, I mean, it's okay, Thailand or abroad. Yeah, you may have like benefit to know about international medical system English. Yeah, some people maybe learn other language, yeah, Latin, so blah blah blah, blah. Yeah, that's good for them. About the life, yeah, you have to living by yourself. Yeah, you have more about your maturity. You prepare yourself, try to take care of yourself. Yeah, that's one of the good things. I met the great teacher and great mentor. I like them, and they really care and support you. So that's the things. But it doesn't mean it in Thailand it's not good mentor, right? But for me, it's like that's my experience. Friend and family. Yeah, some of my friends got family. Right? Yeah, some kind of like their partners and stay there. And a lot of good friends that you can meet. Cultural exchange, yeah, travel. Some people like train in the US and go a lot of, went to a lot of places. Money, one thing is like, yeah, I told already, like, I feel that it's reasonable. Salary that I got, I don't have to do like moonlighting. It's a good thing. Maybe that's a good part, right? Bad one for me, bad one. I think this one, we have to think more about like some specialty. I mean, it's mean that maybe you still have to go abroad. Yeah, if you like to train in some specialty or something that in Thailand we don't have, but sometimes maybe you study here first, study training in Thailand first and go to do just some part, something like that. Yeah, because some specialty right now that for I know is like cardiologist, nephrologist, kidney doctor, cardiologist, heart doctor. I'm not sure about GI. That they said that you have to kind of like let's say for nephrologist and GI and cardiologist, if you train American board, when you came back to Thailand, you have to did the exam, like fully exam, like they have 3 days exam that you have to did like as the same as the Thai training. Why? They said that sometimes, like let's say nephrologist, they said that the system for the dialysis, kind of like a healthcare, public health, may be different in Thailand and in other countries. So they make it the same, same thing, same idea. So that's why I rarely seen my friend who trained nephrologist in the US and came to Thailand. So they stay over there. I have like my friend, a couple of my friends who are nephrologists. They still work in the US. They did not plan to come back. But for me, like I'm the internal medicine, infectious disease. When I came back, I did some exam, but more like a oral test, talk, and then kind of like some discussion. I did not have to do paperwork, fully exam. But I'm not sure about the certificate, about the examination like this in Thailand maybe change over time. Okay. About the bad thing, sometimes maybe it's too much or not about the specialty, like over qualification at some point. You train too much, but come to Thailand, you get paid at some point. They will not pay you more, something like that. This is the I'm not sure we can call it bad or not. And sometimes some disease in Thailand is you have to learn here in Thailand. I went to the US, I rarely seen we call melioidosis. I don't know, do you know melioidosis? It's like the bacteria, gram-negative bacteria, this bacteria, Burkholderia pseudomallei, is usually with the soil, Isan, right? Northeastern part of Thailand. Yeah, we are in the country of this disease, but in the US, no, I have no idea. In the US, melioidosis is the like a tier one specimen about the we call the what they call the disease agent disease that we afraid that they gonna use for the bad thing. So yeah, we did not see much about the real patient with this melioidosis. So when I came back, I have to learn. Yeah, in Thailand, we have seen the patient with melioidosis. Sometimes about the medical experience, teamwork, some people have this problem. Like in the US, the training is one system. In Thailand, this different, the style of training, the teamwork is maybe different. But this one actually maybe no problem if you practice a little bit of, you have some experience in Thailand before. For me, this one you can get used to. This one is the same idea. Kind of like when you came back, people like told that maybe you too much too international, right? Yeah, I don't know. This is the good or bad things, but yeah, sometimes you have to get used to. This is like Thailand. Life. Yeah, sometimes there's nothing, no one. Yeah, I went there one time, I got like low back pain, very severe, and no one can help, can ask, something like that. So yeah, this one is the thing that you have to see, have to concern. Yeah, I think one bad thing is like the food, right? That's like Thailand is the best about the food. But right now you have a lot of things, right? You can bring over there. Yeah, some cultural different, maybe you have to think about this. If you so quiet, yeah, in Thailand it look good. Sometimes like people in Thai people did not like the one who like over expression, talk too much, show yourself. But in the US, if you quiet, too quiet, sometimes they thought that you have no idea, yeah, right? You like seem to be like, have no idea, something like that. So you have to think about this and make the appropriate expression. And another thing, is the a lot of investment. I think the fee for the exam now I think is around 100,000. So have to think about this. If you have to ask your family member to support, you have to think about this. Like myself, I think at that time when I did it, I just have to do more and more because you cannot stop it. You have to keep going. Actually, for me, I did not really plan. I can tell you, I have no idea about USMLE, USMI, I cry, something. I have no idea. But some of my friends, they did the exam. So, and at that time, I was in the Sirirat Hospital preclinical program. So I just thought like, oh, okay, maybe I review, already have to review about this exam. So I did this exam. That's it. So have you made your own decision? Have you made your own decision? I like you to think that who should make this decision? Is it you or your mom? Is it you or your dad? Right? Because it's like this one needs to be from you. And now it doesn't need to be the final one. But have to think about it. Think about it. Because I got a lot of complaints like, oh, why my daughter, my son did not go abroad. I have to tell the parents that ask your children, don't ask me, right? I'll give them the learning, give them a lot of opportunity, but you have to be the person who make decision. So if you ask me how to, that's kind of like a one thing you have to think, right? Good, bad, something may be good for someone, something may be this one is good, someone said, oh, this bad. So you have to think about this. But if you want to be a good applicant, if you want to be a good applicant, you have to make some profile. For me, as I told you before, it's kind of like you have to get some information. What you need is the information. Some of you guys did some elective at the US, right? I saw some went to Chicago, something, the psychiatric hospital, right? So you can see, oh, this is the US system, or they treat the patient like this, something like that, right? That you have some experience that what you can face if you did the training over there. One thing I have to tell you, the residency training in the US and in Thailand, a little bit of some idea of training is like this. For us, after you graduate 6 years of training, right, in the medical school, we expect you to be a doctor in Thailand. In Thailand, when you train 6 years, you graduate, you are a doctor. No matter right now, maybe a little bit of like, maybe you cannot see much enough patient like when I were the medical student, right? Because now there's a lot of medical school, a lot of regulation. But for me, I still believe that in Thailand, we see a lot of people. We still expect that when you train 6 years in the medical school, maybe you have to do like we call internship, 1 to 3 years. And like myself, I did internship 1 year. It's like I saw a lot of cases. Yeah, I think I did the cesarean section more than 30 cases. I did the, when I trained in the medical school at Sirirat Hospital, I did like appendectomy only one case when I was the medical student. But for my intern year, I cannot remember more than 20 or 30 cases for sure. So this I told you doesn't mean I want to show myself, but I want to ask you to think like actually like some people like to like just finish and train, right? But actually in terms of to be a doctor, you need to do like some practice. Yeah, in one intern year, the internship year may give you a lot of experience. May give you a lot of experience. And actually that things is the when they try to find some applicants, they ask, they like to get that good applicants from that, actually, right? Yeah, the one who have some more experience about seeing the patient. Actually, they like some people like that to be in their system, right? In the US, after they graduate, like 4 years of the training, because in the US, they have to get the bachelor degree first, right? And then train in medical school for 4 years. After medical school, if the for the US system, they have to go to the residency training right away. Yeah, the one who did not go to residency training, that they may have problem. They usually change their career to like researcher at some point. Yeah, so this one is different. So that's why that's the things that maybe you have to think about when you try to like make your profile. Think about this, like you want to leave Thai system and like apply for the matching right away, or maybe you practice a little bit, get you some more experience. It depends, it's up to you. I cannot tell you, but I told you only like pro and con when you get some experience to like seeing the patient. So and one thing, right, about the you need to know the system. Another thing is about the knowledge. They like to evaluate, right, your knowledge. So your score maybe some part that they may select me, may be able to like classify you guys. This one you have to ask some more information. Some of the program maybe like they cut off like 90% or something. They just want to like get rid. Let's say they got 1,000 of applicants, 100 of applicants, but they like to select maybe 30 applicants to like have face-to-face interview. So that's why they have to try to have some selection criteria. Some of my friends got bad score for USMLE exam, but right now he is the professor that in the US right now, right? Because he got bad score, but maybe he did not good when he did the MCQ exam at some point, but he did more about the observership, did some research more. So it's okay when the professor over there saw him more about his performance. So he got into the system and now he's the professor in the US right now. So this one, yeah, you just have to think about this. The same idea with the GPA. Yeah, the score is not 100% that we can make decision. Yeah, you get good score, but for the interview, you talk something bad, you like have no idea what did you do, that's, I don't think that they're gonna select you, right? And about the medical profession, for me, medical profession is important because the knowledge you can train, you can like, you know, like you come to the training program for your training to make you improvement about your knowledge, but your attitude, your performance, how you can communicate, take care with the patient, with the your team, right? If you bad guy, if you like have no friend, how that the program should like select you into the team, right? Yeah, so that's it. And English and communication skill, yeah, for our EP student, maybe this is not the problem, but you have to make yourself more in terms of the professional. How to, Ajahn He will tell you more about how to interview, to make the CV. That's one is the another key things. Anyone got US citizenship? If you get this, you are the best applicant already. Yeah, you have like 50% chance to get if your mental is okay. I think you may got it. You may got the position. Because this one is about the system. Yeah, when you get the U.S. Citizenship, maybe you have more advantage in terms of to apply something, some research application, blah, 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 blah. I'm not sure right now, the economy system of the world changed. Maybe, I'm not sure about this one, but when the before, like if you got like U.S. citizenship, you may get more chance to be an applicant. Or you from like U.S. affiliated medical school, you have some more connection. You got like some people from over there, blah, blah, blah. Usually you have to select the program that they're familiar with Thailand, not Taiwan, right? Thailand. When I were there, like people confused Thailand, Taiwan. They're confused, but now maybe they know, right? They know Lisa, right? They know Lisa right now. Maybe people know Lisa is from Thailand. Maybe they know you. Maybe, I'm not sure. But you can select when I apply, before I got like the we call IMG, internal medicine, the familiar program. Like I did training in University of Hawaii, for example, a couple of program in Texas, a couple of program in Chicago. They're familiar with Thai people. Usually they did, your senior did very well, right? So they have good reputation. See about specialty opening position. Let's say family medicine maybe is more open than internal medicine. Pediatrics, surgery may be difficult, but not zero, because one of my friend, a couple of my friend also trained as a surgeon in the US, but it's maybe more difficult. Like this one, I'll tell already, like less IMG for like dermatology, radiology, anesthesia, so some type of surgeon. For the internal medicine, maybe something with the procedure also like more popular. And this one I'll leave to Ajahn Thep about the ECFMG process, because now I'm not sure, like they change a lot already, but you have to plan for the in summary here, it's kind of like a, for me, you have to plan. Let's say you have to make some timeline that when you're gonna like matching, right? When you have matching, what you need, some program need you to get like step one and two completely. Step three, actually not mandatory, but if you want to apply for some visa, you may have to apply or take the step three as well. For myself, at that time, I took step one and two complete before apply. So when I apply, I did some observership and go over there for interview at the same time. And after that, I did the step three. Because otherwise, you can did step three when you like first or second year of your training is okay. But some of my friends, they did everything and they can apply for, they call it H1 visa. But this one, I'm not sure about the process right now, maybe change. But for me, you have to do timeline. You have to do some timeline. Okay. And this one is kind of like some of my summary about the good applicant. First step, good CV, right? Because they find you from CV first. So this one, I think Ajahn Thep will tell you more. Good CV, good personal statement. For me, with the international student, you understand about CV, about personal statement. For myself at that time, I have no idea what is personal statement, what is CV. Because in Thailand, you did not have to do much about CV. Yeah, I got to the my position, did not use the CV when I was just graduate. But right now, I think the people understand more about the CV, about the resume. So you have to prepare about this one. But for me, I think I like you to make yourself. You don't have to pretend, but because if you try too much to pretend something, you will get some problem. Let's say you want good letter of recommendation, but you're a bad guy. How can I give you the good letter of recommendation, right? If I haven't seen you never work with me, how can I give you the recommendation, letter of recommendation, right? Usually people can get letter of recommendation, they will get from the dean, but the dean will give kind of like in general, overall, maybe some comment from some professor that you work during some rotation will come to the dean letter. But otherwise, about the other things, you have to find like someone who know you, someone who like, oh, okay, can give you some ideas, can give people some idea. Who are you? Something like that. And find some connection. This is also important, find some connection and prepare for interview process. Prepare for interview the process. Okay, that's my overview of my comment, my idea about the good or bad. For me, every step is your learning experience. I don't think that you have to skip something but you just have to think this is maybe your good experience. My research, first research that I did is about microalbumin. Microalbuminuria. That's the first research or first thing about the research. And actually, I did not want to do. My professor at Sirila said, like, you have some time, maybe you help me do this thing, something like that. So that's one. No. Okay. Open your mind and be mindfulness. That the you have to wait to go about. One thing for me is stress. You will get a lot of stress. Be careful about this one and try your best. Try your best. Preparation, practice will make perfect. Yeah, but no one perfect at the beginning. Otherwise, you don't have to train. And just don't regret what you did, what your decision. No, and that's about it. Yeah, you will get it if it's yours, right? Okay. Thank you. Any question, feel free to ask. No? Thank you. Okay. Anyone have some problem, some question that I can help? Or otherwise, yeah, you can still contact me. No? Okay, okay. Thank you.
So thank you again to Chanantra. Okay, guys, so we're going to get started. Does anybody know, after 6 years, what you have to do in Thailand? What, after 6 years, what do you have to do? I think some of you don't know. Does anybody know? She says 3 years of internship. Does anybody, do you guys think that that's what you have to do? So once you finish, because you graduate from Thammasat, right? At the end, you have a degree from Thammasat. So then you have to Chaithun, usually around 3 years, but it can depend, right? There's some things that don't require 3 years. So then you have 3 years, but you can do it at certain places. You can go to Dang Chong Wat, or you could do it at Thammasat. Then after that, if you finish those 3 years, then you'd be eligible to do what? Residency, right? Then do you guys know how long residency lasts? 3 to 5, okay. Three, you know, like for medicine, ENT here in Thailand is only 3 years, right? And then you can go on to do some subspecialty training. So just so you guys, that's just your training, right? So when you graduate medical school, you're technically a general practitioner. So nowadays you can go to residency. Nowadays they have alternatives to residency, like getting a master's degree. But yeah, right? And then once you do that, if you don't do that, you have to pay money back. If you don't do internship, you guys know that. You have to pay money back to the government. So many steps. Like if you're only in year three, you still have 3 and then still 10 years of doing this stuff. So, right? So going into medicine is definitely not a sprint, like a marathon. Okay. So just so everybody understands, because we got a lot of questions about this. So what's USMLE? Everybody talks about USMLE. What does that mean? So first of all that means in Thailand, they call it USMLE. And I don't really know how they came up with the term USMLE, but it's USMLE. So if you say USMLE in America, nobody's going to know what you're talking about. So it's just USMLE because that's the acronym for United States Medical Licensing Exam. The information in the USMLE is the same as the NL exam. It's the same content, but maybe asked in a different way. So you guys will take, do you know how many times you take the NL? How many steps in the NL, you know? 3. Okay. So when you finish third year, you guys will be all stressed out and taking the NL before you go on to clinics. But then you have to take like a comprehensive exam before you take the NL. So technically, NL is equivalent to like step one, USMLE step one. So it's an online exam that takes about 8 hours, okay, the whole day. So some people, if you're very studious, you could take it at the same time as your NL. You could, because it's the same content. But with USMLE, you only get one chance. Plus, it costs like $800 to take just one test. You take it once, because once you pass, that's your score. You can't change it. So now step one is pass fail. So you either pass or you fail. And what you should know is that these tests are based upon who takes the test. So if you take a test with a bunch of smart people, then your score will be affected. If you take the test with a bunch of people who just barely make it, then you might have a score that is affected also. For the most part, Thai doctors who go to the US for training score in the 90 up percentile. So the content is never an issue. The biggest barrier for most Thai physicians going to the US to train is what? Any guess? What do you guys think? So usually that's nowadays sometimes the biggest barrier because most of them are not enrolled in an English program. But in terms of the scientific content, they have the highest percentile already. So that gives you an idea of what all this means. So then you have to take step one, then you have to take step two, because then you have to take, but also remember step two is at the same time as in you're already on clinics. So it's when, after year five, you have to take step NL2. So do you think you would be ready to take NL2 in addition to another 8-hour exam where the score is super important? Maybe. It's all an individual decision. There's tons of practice tests. There's tons of things because you have to predict how well you're going to do. You don't just go take a test blindly. You have to know, okay, I'm going to take this test. I paid $800 and I'm going to get into the 99th percentile, because usually the practice test predicts what you're going to do unless something random happens. So we're just talking about the test. That's just the test to like be considered. So then you have to do it again. There's two different ways, but so right, there's NL 1, 2, 3, there's step 1, 2, 3. Okay. But the last step, like Atanantra said, you can actually already be training and that's not required. So the step one, step two. And then there's this other step two, like CS that they used to have. They still have, but now you can do an alternative. All that is to check to see how your English is. And I know that because I went to medical school where there were many residents that were foreign medical graduates, and many of them were not strong in English. So they have to know whether or not you're going to be able to take care of a patient completely in English without having a barrier. So that's why they developed that thing. Okay. But now there's an alternative because they changed it during COVID so that it was an easier way to complete that final step. So that all of that. So this is just a question to throw at you. Do you think you'd be comfortable doing that right now? Maybe not, maybe. So if anything that this provides you is that gives you knowledge on what exists, because you can alter your plan and your plan will change. At the end of the day, what Atanantra is stressing is that it's all up to you, right? You may find a boyfriend who wants you to do something else, but you shouldn't let anybody else tell you what to do, or your parents want you to do something else or whatever. So all those things will affect what you decide and whether or not this is what you want to do. And I think some people use it, that's why they want to go to the US in the beginning. That's just what they want. That's up to them. So they figure out how they're going to make that work for them. But there's always a risk benefit. I have a student right now that is an intern this year. They want to do something very competitive, super competitive. Now they're deciding they're an intern. Is it worth doing what they're doing now? Because they don't have time to study. Because for these tests, you have to study. But if I just invest in my time and just study for this test and I don't complete internship, I'm not eligible to be a resident. And I can't be a resident in Thailand. Okay, so then I have to consider what are my other options. If I stay in Thailand, do I want to be a GP? Do I want to get some other type of degree to do what I want or what? Okay. So these are the questions that they want you to hopefully be able to start thinking about. And your benefit, your advantage that you have is English is not a barrier to you. So you already have that. You have an advantage. Depends on if this is important enough to you that you would want to do or not. It doesn't matter. It doesn't hurt my feelings if you go to X, Y, and Z, you know. Ultimately, everybody here would just want you to be able to do whatever your dreams are. A 6-year student just texted me that they got into where they wanted to for the field they wanted to. So I'm happy for them. Ultimately, you want your students to be happy in whatever they do. It doesn't matter where it is. But we just want to give you the knowledge to know what your options are. Because if we don't have this, people are maybe curious, you know, why does Jula in the Thai program, why do they have like 5 kids go per year? And you guys go to an English program, like why is there not more people who go from a program that's catered to learning in English? So the other thing that, just so that you know, so you can compare yourself, like how is it different? Okay, so in the United States, they have to go to college first. So if they go to college for 4 years and get some type of degree, and then they go to college, not college, they go to medical school for additional 4 years. So instead of 8 years, you guys do 6 years. So you already cut off 2 years. So then after that, you do medical school, right? And then you do residency, which can range from 3 to 9 years. What's the 9 years? Is neurosurgery. My friend was a neurosurgery resident, okay? And then you can do fellowship. You can do specific training, all right? So I did 4 years there, 4 years here. I did 5 years here, and then I did additional year. So if you count that, that's what? 13, 14 years just to train to do some specific field. So you can see how different it is. So we already went over this a little bit, but now you want to understand, okay, how is what I'm doing different from what they're doing? So they're doing 2 years of preclinical years. You guys do 3 because it's already meshed into that. And then they take step 1. You're equivalent to NL1. So you did 1, 2, 3, then took NL1. So you could do all of that and know the same, technically the same content as a medical student there. All right. And then we take this step 2 right before we graduate. And then you could take step 3 whenever. So this one is the one that CK means clinical knowledge. So it's like a MCQ test. CS is the one they basically are testing you on your skills to understand English. Because it's a standardized patient that you have to interview and show that you understand what they're talking about and be able to explain to them. Same thing that you will do in OSCE in Thailand. Because you know you have an OSCE in Thailand. You know that? Where you have to like talk through the problem. And then you have training. So this is, I just had this when I was in med school. This is what I learned. That's my schedule. But we had to learn. So all the things that, you know, it's similar. Intro to clinical medicine, pathology, pharmacology. What else? Physio, neuroscience, all of that. Anatomy. How do you know if you're basically studying for the test is self-administered. So when I went to medical school, by the way, which you can't do in Thailand, I rarely went to class. I studied on my own in medical school because that's how at that level, you really know how to study. You actually have to know how to study. Okay. But this gives you an idea. So if you like get so many percent, that's going to give you an idea if you're going to pass, do very well, or do in the 90th percentile. There's all these banks you can pay for online. So this is a sample. This is also when I was in med school. This is what I would do. Like basically you finished med school and then you had summer. So you had to take it in the summer. And if you didn't pass, you would delay your ability to start. So you can see it's a lot. Like a lot. And depending on, everyone has different levels of how much, you know, knowledge they have or how much they need to study. So it's all independent. It's all dependent on the individual. Okay. So this is updated information. Okay. So every year they do a match. They say, okay, how many people applied? How many people got in? All right. So I pulled all the data that's related to international medical graduates. They refer to it IMG. What Ajahnanta said was like FMG. They use the terms interchangeably. So IMG means that you come from an international medical school and you are not a U.S. citizen, which is the U.S. citizen part, like Ajahnanta said, is very important. Why? Because it depends on your visa. Because when you have a visa, the hospital has to pay for that visa, has to pay the government. So if you're already a US citizen, they don't have to worry about all that paperwork. All right. But you can see these are the top, I guess, five specialties that international medical graduates who are not US citizens get into. So if you want to do one of these, it's a higher likelihood. If I want to be a neurosurgeon, it's lower, not impossible, because last year there was a Thai graduate who got into neurosurgery at Duke. Have you ever heard of Duke? Like university? That's like a very big school. But he was also a PhD. You know what a PhD, right? PhDs are all the people teaching you preclinical sciences. So I think he's an MD PhD, meaning he probably has a lot of research. Okay. So that even says how many, 2,000 in each specialty. Okay. So look at some other statistics, because this gives you an idea of what I am up against, or what is it, you know, worthwhile for me to invest in. So when we look at it, this is last year, so 2022, so in the midst of the pandemic, okay? So non-US citizens from international medical schools. Why do they say that? Because there are US citizens who cannot get into medical school in the US, and they have to go out of the country. Most of them are in the Caribbean. So to be honest, I think non-US international medical graduates have a higher advantage than those students. Why? Because these students are from their home country. Those students had to leave their country to go to medical school. So it's a different, might be a different population. All right. So if you look at it, so in 2022, how many people applied? 7,000. Okay. Matched means they got a spot. PGY1 means postgraduate year one. It means your first year. It's your intern year. Their intern year, first year, use the same term. Okay. So you can see 4,571 who did not match 3,000. So over 50%. So that's a better statistic than even what Ajahnantras had thought. You know? Okay. But then you see those who withdrew who said, I'm not doing it, or those who didn't submit a rank list. Because how it's done there is basically they give you an interview, right? And you go and they interview and you talk with them. And then at the end of the day, you rank it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. And then basically you rank who you like the best, and they rank who they like the best. And then a computer figures it out. Okay, so you can see the number of foreign trained physicians hasn't really changed. It's about 10,000. Again, you have to think about Thailand has how many million people versus the United States. So you're thinking 10,000 people that are foreign medical graduates, meaning Thailand, Africa, wherever. Okay, and then you can see out of everybody who applies, how many of them are from a foreign medical school. So it would be this group, non-US citizens who went to a international school. So that's like almost 25%. That's not low. Okay. So now let's look at the specifics. They go through all the specifics. This is why I can tell you that there's a lot of structure in the US, right? Training, residency. Most training in Thailand is, in terms of like the structure, is a carbon copy of what they've done in the US previously. There's so many things that you might not think about that are actually part of the necessary training, like ethics and stuff like that. So if you look at it, so you say, I want to be an anesthesiologist. Who knows what an anesthesiologist is? You all know what an anesthesiologist is? What do they do? Yeah, more important, it's the one who wakes them up. Okay, because if you don't wake them up, that's the main problem. So you can see they have that many positions in the US, almost 2,000. And how many non-US international medical graduates got in? Almost 100. couple of years ago, there was an anesthesiologist from Chiang Mai who was already a staff at Chiang Mai, and then they went and started over again and went to there. So Vivi and Prayer, they went to where? UIC. So you know where she went to medical school? Dula. She's one of the only few ophthalmologists that's board certified in the US that went to a Thai medical school. Although there's one at Siri Lanka, they have one. But if you go and look at ophthalmology, where's ophthalmology on the list? It's not even on the list, right? But okay, super competitive is like plastic surgery. There's only 194 spots in the country of the US. And then how many? Six of them. So you can see how you start to understand how it's all, it's a numbers. You have to start looking at numbers, okay? You want to be an orthopedic surgeon, right? How many spots are there? There's 875. And how many got in? 17. Does that make sense? So this is all freely available on the internet. They publish this every year. So I think it's important for you to, you know, if I want to do ABC, what's the likelihood of, what do I have to do to get that point? Or even, you know, maybe I do want to be an internist, but I want to go to Stanford or I want to go to Harvard. What's the likelihood of me getting into Stanford or Harvard? You have to go and find that information out. Is it impossible? No. There was a resident at Stanford. Okay. So, you know, you may not understand even the process in Thailand, which is a little bit different and less clear, but you should understand how it is, you know, if that was ever your goal. And then this is from a year ago, but then you start seeing like, okay, what do I have to look at in terms of scores? So this tells you, okay, how many people who got in, which is the match, and what was their average score? 234. So what's the peak? It's around, you know, what, 255 or something like that. Okay. So then you have to look at some other things, you know, how many research experiences did they have? But look at the difference between US people and non-US people. So these things have to be higher because it's a little bit of an uphill battle, but not impossible. So the application process, you know, you apply. What Atanantra said, she had that certificate. You have to get that certificate to apply because that says you've passed all the step exams and now you're eligible to just apply. And however long it took you to get to that step, okay? Then you have your transcript, USMLE. So I was talking to a group earlier. So my friend that I met, she was the first person from Thammasat. She's probably the only person from Thammasat who has ever went to, but she was the first one. So she is a nephrologist, and it was random because I met her when we were both fellows together, and they had like whatever, they had like orientation, and when you're even in med school, you have to carry your diploma and show them that I graduated medical school and this is my proof. And she sat next to me and I was like, where's your med school from? And she was like, Thammasat. And I was like, it's random because I didn't even think she looked Thai. But she was the first one. So she said she had to get all the transcripts. You have to get all this paperwork that says I went to medical school from the dean or whatever. And nobody here knew what this was all about. They're like, we don't know what that means. So she had to start from scratch. Like basically tell them what she needed to get all this paperwork done. Okay. So basically how it happens is, they look at your board scores and they look at your GPA, where you're from, what medical school, right? If you're foreign or if you're a citizen. And then that's how they make one big cut, right? You have to, because how many thousand people, no one has time to read 1,000 applications. After that, then do you go to the second round? And then they have an interview, okay? And then after you interview, you just rank. And you rank to see what's the best thing that you can do. Anyway, so I just pulled this. So what people have to eventually do is they have to go find places that would probably welcome them as an applicant. So this is just one of the places. And I only reason I, this is where I went to medical school. So where I went to medical school has a bunch of Thai residents. And it started because I think there was a Thai cardiologist in the community who became friends with the dean. And then they started accepting Thai graduates. So this is at Texas Tech. So it's in very rural Texas. But yeah, so it talks about, you know, you have a visa and how many years you've had to have finished medical school within the last 7 years or so. You don't have to have U.S. clinical experience, but it might be preferred. So what is that? So you have the opportunity when you're in 6 year to go abroad and they give you money. The Faculty of Medicine gives you money. So if this is something you're thinking of, I would plan on something like that. Because when you're a medical student, to go and do an elective is way easier than when you're not a medical student anymore, because you're underneath the umbrella of the medical school. So go to UCLA, go to wherever. They have University of Hawaii, UCLA. UCLA is for all, like, in CICM. University of Hawaii, that's with the Faculty of Medicine. They have a MOU. So those are opportunities that you can go, you know, to get that experience. And then they talk about different types of hospitals. You can go to like a medical school, right? Right. The same thing in here. You could go to Jula, or you could go to Chonburi. They have something there that's not with a medical school, right? It's just a training program. Okay. So there's different things to think about. So this is somebody that this person is now a GI fellow in the US. So they went and did residency here in Thailand, and then they did it all over again in the US. So you can see how well this individual took his steps while he was a resident. So everybody has different ways of doing it, but you just have to do well, okay? And these people, they spent months just to practice their English. So 1 year I did this, maybe like 2 or 3 years ago, one of the applicants who got in that year said that he basically memorized everything, because his English was not strong, but he just memorized everything. So he would just know how to respond. And now he's a resident in the US. So you can do whatever to accomplish your goals. Like, it doesn't matter, you know? And it's like some white guy that is in Siam Square that, like, they use to learn English. It's like the same guy. Like, this is his name. He, like, does this. He, like, teaches medical English, apparently. So we won't go through, because most of you guys are still in med school, but you have to do a whole personal statement. But I think these things are important, but these things don't make or break you unless you just write something horrible. Sample, you have to have letters of recommendation. So then we look, so they actually update this every year. So you can see where people got in. So just last year, you can see like there were 11 people who got into internal medicine, and you can see where a lot of them got into that school in Texas, or where John Nantra went is in Hawaii, about 3 of them. So you can see it spread out and what different specialties. So you just have to have a goal, and then decide if that is something that you want to do or pursue. Research is important. I think it's super important. So this is a study that I did with med students. Okay? And this is a pretty good journal. But who wrote most of it were med students when they were like in their third year. They're in the first batch. And doing research doesn't mean like I'm going to go to the U.S. Neither one of them are in the U.S. One is still doing internship and the other one is like a pediatrics resident. Okay. But you have to do research, by the way, when you're a resident, even in Thailand, just to graduate. But I can tell you most residents have never published anything of this caliber, but they did it as a third year medical student. So that's kind of it. I show these photos only because this is when I was a resident. So that one of the guys, not him, him, he was from a foreign medical school. And you know what he does now? He's a plastic surgeon. So he was from Pakistan. And they have a medical school that like has a high tendency to send their graduates to the US. And he was just a a general surgery resident, and then he always wanted to be a plastic surgeon, and then he got in. That's it. But the point of the story is that the other photos were like when I was a resident and when I was a fellow. So you can learn a lot, and I think it's important that you guys know what the options are for whatever you want to do in your future.